First Cavalry Division at Fort Hood. Commanding General of the Multinational Division at Tuzla in Bosnia. Director of Force Programs in the Office of the Deputy Chief of Staff for Operations in Washington, D.C. His overseas assignments include Vietnam, Germany, and Bosnia. He's a graduate of the Commanding General Staff College, Army War College, recipient of many awards and many decorations. He is a soldier's soldier, particularly outstanding friend. And I'm thrilled to present General Kevin Burns to you, friend of Wentworth, General Burns.
Thank you all very much. It's wonderful to be with you today despite this terrific Missouri weather. I know it's quite uncommon out here. I spent a little time out here myself going to Park College in North Kansas City. It's terrific to come back to Missouri. Congressman and Mrs. Skelton, sir, thanks for everything you do. This is our number one advocate for men and women in uniform and their families. General Little, thank you very much for the invitation. To the students here at Wentworth Military Academy, I'm proud to be among you. And to the young men and women from local schools, I'm glad you're here today to gain an understanding of how important this day is to this country. Freedom is not free. And we have endured as a nation for over 228 years on the backs of men and women in uniform. We owe them very much. Not because I wear the uniform, because the history of this great nation is about service and sacrifice. And over the last 228 years, men and women have put it on the line for this nation. They've served and they've sacrificed so that we and our kids can enjoy the liberties that we all too often take for granted. In time of peace, the citizens of this country don't turn out in large numbers on Memorial Day and on Veterans Day. It takes war for us to understand what it's all about. It takes the loss of a loved one or a friend to understand how deadly serious it is, this business of fighting to sustain our freedoms and taking care of friends in need. So it's important that we gather on a day like Veterans Day to remember. Never forget those who've gone before us and those who are in harm's way now and those preparing to go into harm's way. Because living in America is not easy. Freedom is not free. And it's the brave men and women who secure this liberty for us. And we can't forget them. It's great to have the traveling wall here to commemorate our Vietnam losses. And in this town of Lexington, it's hallowed ground. Blood was shed here during the American Civil War. This is the oldest military school west of the Mississippi. I'm proud to be here celebrating its 125th anniversary. Through all the years, the goals here for the graduates of Wentworth have remained the same, to achieve the honorable in everything that they do. The contribution of the graduates coming out of Wentworth Military Academy are significant. Some distinguished members have graduated here as well. Two Medal of Honor recipients, 17 general or flag officers, and a very senior member of our Congress. But today is about veterans. And Veterans Day commemorates really the end of World War I. The Great War, the war to end all wars. We like to believe that after every conflict. It ended on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month in 1918. 3 years later, on November 11th, 1921, the remains of an unknown soldier who was killed in combat, they were solemnly delivered to Arlington National Cemetery overlooking our nation's capital. Horses drew his flag-draped coffin on the simple carriage that once bore the body of President Abraham Lincoln. That fallen soldier, whose name remains only known to God, was killed while fighting for his country in the trenches of Western Europe. And on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, his soldiers in arms laid him to rest on his home soil. The tomb of the unknown soldier at Arlington serves as a reminder to all Americans that freedom is not free. Veterans of this great country have served in places like Bunker Hill, Gettysburg, the Meuse Argonne, Tarawa, the hilltops along the 38th parallel in Korea, the jungles of Vietnam, Grenada, Panama, Somalia, Afghanistan, and now Iraq. They distinguished themselves in the flak above Berlin. They devastated the enemy's fleets at Midway, and they withstood the hellish fire to secure a foothold for liberty and democracy on the beaches of Guadalcanal, Normandy, and at Incheon. Freedom is not free. And as one walks around the grounds of this noble institution, you're reminded of the cost and the sacrifices made by countless Americans. The Doughboy statue honors the graduates lost in World War I. The Memorial Chapel honors those who gave their lives in World War II and Korea. The UH-1 helicopter memorial recognizes those who died in Vietnam. And the Wall of Honor recognizes those lost to date in the global war on terrorism. In our audience today, we have a number of veterans who've served all over the world. I ask those veterans to please stand and be recognized. Our veterans fought where the nation asked them to go, and they fought with valor, courage. They fought very well, and they continue to fight very well. Many have written about great generations. I think the generation we have today and that generation that's coming into our ranks every day is pretty terrific as well. Our veterans have never marched to foreign shores with notions of glory. They went with a simple notion that people of all nations have a right to live in a world free of tyranny. And they fought with an equally simple conviction that some principles in life are worth dying for. They fought for their country, they fought for the American ideals, they fought for their buddies, their comrades in arms, for a better life and the safety of their families in the future. In the 20th century alone, approximately 650,000 Americans gave their lives, killed in combat, died to keep us safe and our children safe, died to keep the horrors of something like 9/11 away from our shores. Today, our soldiers continue to serve. In the Army alone, 272,000 soldiers serve overseas in over 120 different countries. Over 50 of them are deployed today. Former graduates of Wentworth are deployed today in harm's way, serving in all services, and they're leading men and women of this great nation in battle. Our soldiers today are like those who have gone before us, facing the same challenges on a daily basis. I just visited our soldiers in Iraq. I talked to sergeants, lieutenants, and captains. We're involved, as we always have been, in small unit war today. Our soldiers get it. They are well-led, they are well-trained, and they are well-equipped, and we're going to keep it that way. We're doing everything possible to make them successful. They continue to display the warrior spirit and compassion so typical in an American soldier. Like the unknown soldier, they went off to war, many of them, perhaps, never expecting to come home, to come see the loved ones, their friends. But they're gallantly serving overseas every day, and we are inspired by their service and their dedication to this great nation. Shortly after coming back from Iraq, I visited our wounded soldiers again, Walter Reed. For anyone who served in the Army more than a couple of years, any leader to go visit wounded soldiers in any of our hospitals, you come away totally inspired and you're recommitted to do everything you can to make things right. They're honorable people. No one complaining about their current condition. Some severely physically challenged and will be for the rest of their lives. But they ask about their buddies, they ask about their units. Many of them want to go back, and to a man, to a person, they want to continue to serve. It's inspiring to be with them, and it's a great honor to be able to go visit them periodically. Veterans have done an awful lot for this nation outside of wearing the uniform. When they leave our ranks, they join the ranks of the citizens of this great nation, and they contribute. They contribute to their communities in making America a safer place.
Please be seated.
March, march, march. Color guard, halt. Up, face. Reset, arc.
Retire the colors.
Order, arms. High, heads. On left, arch.
My name is Sam Ratcliffe, class of 65, instructor here at the Academy, and I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome all of our guests and to encourage you to participate in all the activities. This afternoon will be the first session of many speaking engagements and presentations the Academy will present over the next 4 days. To start it off with, let's be concerned about the administration. Please turn your cell phones off, cadets. Beepers. There are restrooms located at the exit signs, both in the rear and to the right. If anyone has any concerns during the period of time, heart attack, whatever, please raise your hand and we'll attend to you. So from the standpoint of administration, I hope that you'll enjoy this. And this likes it to be the first of any presentations.
The Green Beret. Symbol of excellence, a badge of courage, a mark of distinction in the fight for freedom. John F. Kennedy.
In 1952, the United States Army formed a unique organization to combat the unconventional warfare threat and to provide further security for our freedom. That unit the United States Army created was the United States Special Forces. It was based around a 12-man unit of highly trained, skilled professionals, 10 non-commissioned officers, and 2 commissioned officers. That 12-man team later became known as the Special Forces A Detachment. In the late 1950s, the early 1960s, the United States was engaged in supporting an ally in what was then known as French Indochina, later became known as Vietnam. Early in the 1960s, several of these Special Forces aid detachments were dispatched to South Vietnam to assist the local government in repelling the communist aggression from within and from the north. It was in the northern portion of Vietnam, and it was known as the First Military Region, that Special Forces aid detachment 726 from the 7th Special Forces Group at Fort Bragg, North Carolina, deployed for a 6-month TDY mission. 726 was commanded by then Captain Roger C. Donlon, United States Army. 726 had the mission to go into a remote mountainous area in an area called Nam Dong, which translated literally meant 5 cents. And I think if you hear what Colonel Donlon has to say, and if you had the opportunity to perhaps read his book, you can see that was about what was left of the environment later on. The A-Team had the responsibility to pacify the area using the indigenous mountainous tribesmen, known as Molten Yards, and some Chinese, known as the Chinese Dungs. The mission was to recruit, train, and deploy these forces in civic action and combat operations against the hostile force in order to help pacify the area. It was July 1964, when Camp Nam Dong came under a heavy ground attack from a superior numbered communist force. It was during the conduct of this battle that three members of that team, two Americans and one Australian, lost their lives. The commanding officer of that team, Roger C. Donlon, Captain of the United States Army, was wounded several times, but never left the field. After an arduous confrontation lasting several hours, the next morning, Nam Dong was secured and the enemy was repelled. It was for Colonel Don, then Captain, now Colonel Donlon's actions, he was awarded the Medal of Honor, the first such award by the United States Armed Forces during the Vietnam conflict. Colonel Donlon served 30 years in the United States Army, retired in 1988. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure and honor to present to you Colonel Roger C. Donlon, United States Army, retired. Colonel Donlon.
Generated by people in various communities. Like I feel today here at Wentworth, welcome home. It swells great sense of pride within my heart. I say welcome home to Wentworth, but it was in 1980 was my first visit to see a then young and now a little older Colonel John Edwards, and everybody that knows about Wentworth. What's happening here today on Veterans Day, we all had the privilege to get the sense and the feeling of the field house this morning from Jim General and Thomas. You all are fully aware what the meaning history is of Veterans Day. But if I may, a little time I have with you, share how Veterans Day has impacted my life. Some see that I'm playing with a little silver object here. Well, this object happens to be a lensatic compass. It's a very special one for me. It's the one I learned to use as a young Boy Scout, about the age of the youngest here in the class. It was given back to me by my hometown on the 25th anniversary of the Battle of Nam Dong, when they invited myself, now a married man, my wife, and four sons and daughter, and some of my team members, their family. There are no welcome home days in my hometown of Sawbridge, New York. It took me to the old Boy Scout troop, 36, so maybe you would like this. And along with it, they gave me a little certificate, one which might not seem much importance, tenderfoot test record. Well, on this certificate is my father's signature. Inside are signatures of other veterans who were committee men in the scout troop. Daddy signed this certificate authorizing me to become his Boy Scout. He knew, other people knew, and certainly the scout leaders knew that Daddy was on his deathbed. I was too young, too wild to be concentrated. I knew Daddy was sick. It was my job to raise the chickens. But these two things have very great value to me. One is the only thing I have with my father's signature on it. And this compass, I carry it with me because it's a tangible reminder for me that I have to check my compasses. Yes, Glenn's added compasses, but I have to check my other compass. Today, we're all checking our patriotic compasses. We're fortunate to be in the house of God, which will remind us it's important also to check our moral, spiritual, ethical compasses. You young men and women of the Corps are here. People are guiding you, helping you set your course in life. Your primary concern is your academic compass, as it should be, because this is the foundation upon which the rest of your life will depend. You're fortunate, amongst a few fortunate to be here. Be proud of it, make the very best of it, and remember to thank all the people on a daily basis who impacted your life as young cadets. Thank your parents. Never miss the opportunity to thank them for giving you the opportunity to be here. And then thank your chain of command every chance you get. I take this back azimuth on my life. If I may share how my compass was set. I didn't really get to know Daddy, as I would love to have, but he set my course. They had some simple guidelines. Reminded us there's no shame in working hard. Remember that your word is your bond and your signature is a seal to that. I listened to Daddy. He told all of us that on various occasions. Never when we're all gathered. I mention all because I'm one of 10 children. But maybe it was my fate. Born into a 12-man team, meant to go into combat with an 18, another 12. And with going into combat, I had been prepared. When Daddy said, stick to the truth, he reinforced my mother, who was our spiritual compass. Mother would remind us on a daily basis. Family prays together, stays together. Yes, we had challenges. It's a large family. I came along right after the Depression. You read about that in your history. Some tough days. But tough days, tough situations, give people the moral, spiritual, and physical fiber to get through tougher days that lie ahead. And as was stated, not implied, but stated this morning by General Byrnes, tough days are ahead of you, the now generation. You're here to prepare yourselves, and you are. My dream as a youngster was to be able to serve like Daddy did in World War I. My older brothers, four older brothers, all served. I guess if I was honest, the first prayer I ever made up by myself was asking God to please permit me to serve when I grow up. I remember very vividly one morning coming home from church with my mom. It was after Daddy died. No, it wasn't, just before. And the mother says, when we get home, Roger, help me with something special. something special was to put something in the front window. Many of you may have seen this now, because the tradition is coming back. The service bell. I heard about it around the dining room table when the family story was told how Grandma made one, as they all did during World War I, for their loved ones, and then put it in the window. Everybody prayed that that would stay just that color. We prayed, too, that our flag could fall and stay blue, and then white. Prayed that this would never happen. The gold star would have to be placed. Our prayers were answered. But every generation is called upon to make sacrifice. And often that sacrifice includes giving one's life on the Lord's battlefield. This particular flag here is special to my family. Belongs to my wife, who lost her first husband in Vietnam. She knows what sacrifice is. She was still willing to join my team as we built our home team. So my message at this point to the young cadets is reflect upon your brief lives, take a back azimuth, reflect on how your parents, teachers, and coaches have impacted on you. You put that feeling in your heart, that feeling of love and respect. I'm here as a warrior, but I'm here also to tell you, the most powerful weapon on and off the battlefield is love. I'm privileged to be the wearer and bearer of this battlefield. My men, myself, during battle, did not do anything courageous for the sake of hatred for the enemy. What we did, which was a claim to be courageous, is for the love of the man next to you. Then you find out as you grow older how deep that love is and how pure it is and how powerful it is. But you may have been in a leadership position of some nature in combat. And I would emphasize leadership. By virtue of your training and education here, you were all destined to become leaders in some aspect of leadership in our society. If I may digress a moment and just talk about ships. What's a special forces guy going to talk about ships? Well, the ships I want to remind you to think about are followership, leadership, mentorship, discipleship, friendship. These are all the ships that we all sail on from time to time in our lives. My friend, Colonel Edwards and I, we're at a stage in life where we're now sailing gloriously and happily on the ship of friendship. That's in your future. You have a golden opportunity, and this is one of the jewels of Wentworth. As classmates, you start to develop friendships. And these fresh friendships will not be for 1, 2, 4, 3 years. But they have the opportunity and the value that you should cherish these friendships for your entire life. I encourage you to do so. When your day comes, to don a uniform, maybe you're having an opportunity. opportunities come your way that came mine. And by that I mean that I was privileged from day one through my entire 32 years to be associated with great non-commissioned officers. And I remember the very first non-commissioned officer, Sergeant Coffey, U.S. Air Force. That was my first day. Fly. Sergeant Coffey was our drill instructor, flight leader, all wrapped in one, given the mission to give us an orientation of Sampson Air Force Base. He took us out for, seemed like an endless run, heading back to the barracks. He halted our formation, took out a little 3x5 card, called us to attention, and off we went again. You missed something. Well, where I stand today reminds me exactly where Sergeant Coffey took us. He ran us in that door of the chapel and out that door of the chapel, fulfilling his requirement to make sure every new airman knew where the chapel was. On the way out, I picked up a little bulletin. I said, well, maybe I'll find out what time mass is and be able to make it sometime during boot camp. That evening, I opened up the bulletin, and there was a little story in there that I want to share with you. It has a somber message. But we're here celebrating Veterans Day, where we also pause upon the great sacrifice that they never allowed themselves or their families to become discouraged. This article is entitled The Philosophy of Life. Believe it or not, once upon a time, the devil decided to go out of business. He offered his tools for sale to whoever would pay the price. On the night of the sale, they were all very attractively displayed. There was certainly a bad-looking lot. There was malice and hatred and envy, jealousy, sensuality, deceit, and all the other implements of evil. Each marked with his price. Apart from the rest lay a harmless-looking wedge-shaped tool, simplest tool known to man, much worn, yet priced higher than any of the others. Someone asked the devil what it was. That is, discouragement was his reply. Why do you have it priced so high? Because, replied the devil, it's more useful to me than any of the others. I can pry open and get inside a man's conscience with that when I can't get near him with any of the others. And then once inside, I can use him in whatever way suits me best. It's so much worn because I use it with nearly everybody, as very few people know it belongs to me. Well, it hardly need to be added. The devil had such a high price on discouragement. He's never sold it. Still owns it, still using it. Beware of it. Discouragement. Yes, as I said, a somber message. But I would hasten on this occasion to encourage you to focus on the core of that word. Focus for a moment on just the word, but then reflect how that word impacts and has impacted your life. Courage. Reflect for a moment how the various types of courage have impacted on your young lives. You're generally thinking of physical courage. That's where you are. That means a lot at this time. And the man that put it best, in my opinion, about physical courage, was talking about a great football game was about to start between a little place called West Point in Annapolis. It was General MacArthur. When those football players were ready to go onto the field, he reminded them that on the fields of friendly strife are sown the seeds that on other days, on other fields, will bear the fruits of victory. On the athletic field, as well as the classroom, for me, competition in the classroom was some of the toughest. But you to learn how to be courageous. You see other people display their courage. You all now play in some type of team sport. You see when somebody falters, maybe wounded, somebody else picks up the slack. And that's what you're going to be called on for the rest of your life, no matter what arena you find yourself in. That's just physical courage. That's some of the easiest. You're going to find yourself in other settings where you're going to see somebody tell a lie, or would cheat, or would steal. Then what do? Do you have the courage to face them? Do you have the compassion to reach out? For me, courage and compassion are near synonymous for a warrior. When somebody's inflicting a self-inflicted wound, like lying or stealing or cheating, that's hopefully they're on the right team or teammate to recognize it and reach out and help them get their compass back on course. Very few of us can keep our course on life. I don't know of anybody. So we need to be on the right team. So sooner or later, we too as individuals, we're going to need somebody to pull us back so that we can continue the mission that God has set for us. So I urge you to look at yourself, analyze how courage thus far has impacted on your life, find opportunities where you can prove to yourself and to others that you have that courage within you, not just physical, but mental, moral courage. Do what's right. And you've heard it time and time again. It's doing what's right, even when nobody's watching. So I have an eternal gratitude to old Sergeant Coffee, who steered me to this little philosophy on life. I never allow myself to be discouraged. Yes, there have been occasions when I got disappointed in myself or someone else, but I never let it fester to the point of discouragement. Either a good Lord came to my help or a good friend and helped me overcome the challenge. I pray that the same happens for you and that you too can reach out to others. If we project that situation to a little place called Nam Dong, Vietnam in 1964, we prepared ourselves. As Special Forces warriors, we were very confident in our competence, in our capabilities, in ourselves individually and collectively. We were combat multipliers for each other. The very concept of a Special Forces team is, yes, be able to split those 10 experienced NCOs into two five-man teams led by an officer. But those skills were constantly being cross-trained. We were constantly growing, just as you are and you will for the rest of your life. Hopefully you will see the opportunities that present themselves that afford you that chance to continually grow physically, grow in your formal education, grow spiritually and morally. And on that battlefield, when all hell broke out and 800 or 900 surrounded our little camp, our camp head, a 12-man Special Forces group, had approximately 60 Chinese mercenaries, loyal warriors, in our inner perimeter. Outer perimeter, to the local mountain yards we were training. Their loyalty. We were informed before we arrived, maybe 19 were sympathizers to be upon. Untrustworthy. Whenever I hear that word untrustworthy, I again hear my daddy's voice. Remember, that was his message, untrustworthy. Skelton reinforced that, trustworthy. And that's what we had as a team, and we trusted in each other, total trust. And we were pounced upon by a numerically superior force. We found out after the fact, long after the fact, that there were not 19 Viet Cong sympathizers. It was 100. When that battle started, got to be 100 of those 300 in the outer perimeter, stripped their clothes, and all they were wearing was brightly colored loincloths, the uniform of the night for the sappers. So they were already in our camp. Yes, I went back to Vietnam. I met former adversaries, and they took some satisfaction of rubbing it into my nose. They penetrated the outer perimeter, inner perimeter. I said yes, and I commended them for their courage and valor. And I immediately reminded them that anyone penetrated the outer perimeter, inner perimeter, never made it out. He immediately reminded me and said, yes, all 18 of them. 18 of his men made that ultimate sacrifice in that inner perimeter. We had no means of communication when that battle started because they had intelligence on us that they knew where and how to destroy it immediately. There's a great NCO once again, Keith Bannon, my common sergeant. He didn't wait for my instruction or Pop Alamo, my senior NCO's instruction, to let higher headquarters know we're under full attack. He just went ahead and did it. Had he not, the rest of the world would have never found out what was going on. That would have been the end of all of us. Message here, great NCO, initiative. You may all be striving and thinking your mind and heart and just striving to be a leader at a different level. If you are that fortunate to become commissioned officers, never fool yourself that you've got all the answers. You go to school on the backs and the hearts of the non-commissioned officer corps. Early in that battle, I happened to be walking guard when it started. We all had pre-designated positions in a mortar pit, which was the only fortified position. They were already manned. Manning 24 hours a day. Some of my men heading for it. I could see the illumination of burning buildings. Sergeant Brown heading off this direction with his interpreter, George. George stood about this tall. Halfway to that mortar pit, George was no longer this tall. He was this tall. A 57 recoilless rifle cut him right off the knees. Stop running. That's physical courage. That's guts. He ran for about six more paces, and that was the end of his life. I witnessed it. Brownie saw it to the corner of his eye. Three of the enemy were already on top of that mortar pit. They saw it and were stunned. They were stunned for a moment. It was only that moment that Brownie needed to eliminate them, and he continued to his mortar fighting position. Those types of sacrifice inspire you beyond all belief. It seemed like no sooner when that happened, my medic told me, John Houston, one of my youngest men on the team, had just been killed. Later deduced that he was killed by one of those 18 that penetrated. John was killed. Yes, I'll have to admit. I asked God, why John, why not me? Because I knew what John had shared with me the night before in a letter from Alice, that they were soon to be the proud parents of twins. I didn't realize that I was the only person on the team that knew that until sometime later in the hospital. Alice did give birth. Prematurely. George survived. If I were in Arlington today, I would go to Sergeant John Houston's gravesite, U.S. Army, Distinguished Service Cross, Purple Heart, killed in action 6 July 1964. Then I'd post myself to the opposite side of that same headstone, John L. Houston, Jr. Casualties of war are not limited to the battlefield. We learned it once again on 6 July 64. We as a nation, we as a world learned it once again on 9/11. The battlefield has been redefined. And it's a battlefield in which you, men and women, are going to prepare yourselves to become victorious. As General Byrnes pointed out this morning, the enemy that you will face will be the same enemy that we faced in the past, but couched in a little different. They're looking, searching, and attacking our very moral fiber and what our freedoms are, looking to find weaknesses. That's why it's going to call upon each and every one of you to be as strong and as courageous in every aspect of your life so that you will be victorious against the enemy who you're now calling terrorists. Terrorism is not new. Mankind has always been. It was there on 6 July 64, period. How did the enemy get the intelligence on where our communications was? It's a little girl that my medic took care of was ordered by the Viet Cong when she got well to count the paces between the flagpole and the antenna. The flagpole where I slept and other Americans slept. So those things happened. Then lo and behold, not only my youngest soldier made ultimate sacrifice, but later in the battle, trying to evacuate one of the mortar positions about to be overrun, I carried my senior non-commissioned officer. We were blasted back into that pit. How long I was unconscious, I don't know, but I woke the pop dead in my arms. A veteran of World War II, a veteran of Korea, who comes back to the sound. And died in the jungles. As fate would have it, his wife also was expected. And she lost their child. Those are tough, disappointing, and they could be stories that would discourage you. But I share them not to be. Just remind you of the reality of life and death. Remind you you have a golden opportunity here. Take full advantage of that. I want to commend you what you are doing here. I want to commend the parents and the faculty, others that are supporting you. Because you are being molded to be the great generation. From what I hear, good things from you and of you, you're going to be ready. Just as the message that I got at home, reinforced in scouting, be prepared, that's what it's all about. Be prepared for the battles in life. Sometime this afternoon, I will go to the wall, as maybe many of you will. And I will go to that first panel where one of your own is listed on 1E, and that's for Pop Alamo. It's like John Houston's also. Not so far down below their names is also Lieutenant John Kirby, the late husband of my wife. When I touch the wall, Top Alamo and John Houston. I'm touching the soul, and I feel my soul being touched in return. Just recently, I met with, we had a small reunion of six members of the team, and at the present was the surviving son, 40-year-old George Houston. There's something he did and shared with us during that meeting that I'll forever remember and cherish. First, he showed me a picture. He said he came to Fort Bragg for the first time in his life. He wanted to thank the special forces people who gave his father a proper and honorable burial. There was a service in Florida before he was taken to Arlington. His flag-draped coffin was being led into the chapel, about this size, at the front of his father's chapel. The tall Husky warrior was carrying a small white coffin. And George looked at that. He looked at me in the eye and he says, "You know, sir, I lost my daddy. Did I work?" He paused for a moment, looked deeper into my eyes, really into my soul, and said, "I also lost my brother." It's memories like that that give me the courage to continue. Continue to serve in any way I can. Continue to serve as I was inspired to by my dad, for the brothers, family, and all the people that touched my life. And I hope that the little message that I shared with you today will inspire within you the desire to serve. Right now, your mission is to serve members of the Corps, serving your various leadership positions as they come. Do your very best to keep that corner in your heart and everything you do, and call it service to others. In closing, allow me to share a special blessing that was given to me 36 years ago. It's the inscription in my wedding ring. And to you cadets especially, be mindful that what we are is God's gift to us. What we become is our gift to God. God bless you and thank you for the opportunity.
Freedom, that details exactly what happened to Captain Nam Dong, but also he has written a book since then called After Nam Dong. It will be sold later today. General Donlon will be around for question and answers if you'd like to speak to him, if you'd like to have an autographed copy of the book. But if you were in those environments, it will be sad and enlightening. If you're not in those environments, I encourage you to read such documentation to give you an idea of what men like Colonel Donlon went through in the fight for freedom. Thank you, sir.
CJ?
Yes, sir.
CJ. There must be some code to that.
Christopher John's my name.
Christopher John.
Okay.
You change, huh? Stemple.
Yes, sir.
Where you hail from?
Oakland, Iowa, sir.
You're an Iowa farm boy, huh?
Yes, sir.
First name?
Charles.
Charles?